Well, good afternoon. Welcome. This is my first time doing this sort of venue, and please be patient with me as we deal with the inevitable glitches. Welcome to the sixth part of Lives of Evidence lecture series, which is coordinated by the Situating Science Shirk Cluster. And all six parts of the Shirk Cluster are available online for you to peruse at your leisure, www.situsci.ca. Have a look, please. This particular event is sponsored by three different groups. It's sponsored by the Situating Science Cluster, so thank you. It's also sponsored in part by the Institute for the History and Philosophy of Science and Technology. We are housed over here in the old Vic building. And it's also sponsored by the Jackman Humanities Institute. We have a working group on scientific evidence, and some of the working group members are here, and welcome to you today. The Situating Science is a really interesting attempt. It's a seven-year project that attempts to unite historians, philosophers, sociologists of science to understand science in its context, right? There's the logo right there. And again, if you go to the website, you'll see the remarkable range and depth of the activities that have been conducted in the last 7 years or so. I'm very impressed. It's reinvigorated science studies from a humanistic point of view across this nation and elsewhere. I'm very pleased to introduce our speaker, Stathis Psillos, who is the Rotman Professor of Philosophy, Professor of Philosophy at the Rotman Institute, who will be talking to us about lives of evidence. And the plan is for Professor Psillos to talk for 55 minutes or so. And we are fortunate to have two commentators, Helena Lick-Warnick, who's an adjunct professor and faculty of law at the University of Toronto, specializing in statistical evidence. Thank you, Helena, for coming. And Mike Oldenburg, who's a professor from the University of Guelph, philosophy and zoology, right? Just philosophy? Well, okay, philosophy and zoology. And we'll try to stay on time, 15 to 20 minutes for each of them, and then hopefully we can coordinate the question period afterwards. So without further ado, Stathis, welcome. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm deeply honored to be invited to give this talk in Toronto, in this prestigious institute. I think the Situating Science Program is project or cluster is really something exceptional. I think Canada should be very proud of this. I gave a talk last week in Ottawa. That's my second part, as it were. Last week's talk was more historical. This is going to be more philosophical, but I'm really proud and honored to be part of these activities. So what I'm going to talk about is a kind of a very popular philosophical view about the relation between theory and evidence. The thought is that theory or evidence underdetermines theory. And actually, I'm going to distinguish between two kinds of underdetermination, what I will call deductive, the theory, the evidence does not prove the theory, and inductive, the evidence does not confirm the theory. And the thought is that this underdetermination problem is supposed to have a certain epistemic implication. That in the face of it, belief in theory is never warranted by the evidence. That's the so-called underdetermination thesis. So what I'm going to do is basically start with reviewing various arguments for this claim, and show the presuppositions and the weaknesses using both conceptual analysis and historical examples. Then I'm going to move on to talk a little bit about the role of the relation between evidence and method in science, highlighting the importance or the need to incorporate epistemic values into scientific method. Then I'm going to talk a little bit about the role of social values, which is quite an important element in the underdetermination debate. And finally, I'm going to touch on some implications of this analysis of values for the current death of evidence debate in Canada. So what I call deductive underdetermination is the thought that evidence cannot prove the theory, prove the truth of the theory. And this is actually the combination of two claims, one logical, the other empirical. The logical claim, actually the empirical first, is that all interesting scientific theories have excess content over and above the pieces of evidence, observations, data, etc., that probe them and guide their formation. So theories have more information, give more information about the world than the evidence which leads to them. The logical fact is a trivial logical fact. There cannot be a deductively valid argument whose sole premises are statements expressing available evidence and whose conclusion is a theory with excess content over and above whatever it is asserted by the premises. So that's, in technical jargon, that's a well-known problem or issue within deductive logic, namely that deductive logic is not content increasing. Whatever it is in the premises, you get in the conclusion. You don't have excess content. So the question really is, how can this logical fact generate an epistemological problem? And the answer is that the claim, actually, is that given that the link between the theory and the evidence is not deductive, it's not a proof, we can never justifiably believe in the truth of a theory, no matter what the evidence is. But this claim relies on a hidden epistemological premise, namely that belief in the truth of a theory is justified only if the theory is proved to be true on the basis of the evidence. But there are many reasons to doubt this hidden epistemological premise. And I'm going to first canvas a kind of a historical reason. So I'm going to revisit very quickly a very famous debate. Two different approaches between the method of science that goes back to what we call modern science, that of Bacon and that of Descartes. This was an important historical disagreement which concerned both the origins of knowledge and the canons of theory, appraisal, and choice. Simply put, Bacon was a new inductivist, Descartes was a new deductivist. So Bacon thought what he called new induction was the thought that we start with an exhaustive natural experimental history of the phenomenon we want to investigate, for instance, the nature of heat, plus an elimination of alternative hypotheses. How? Via what Bacon introduced as the tables of presences, absences, and concomitant variations. As he put it, the process of exclusion is the foundation of true induction, but the induction isn't completed until it arrives at something affirmative. So the affirmative, that is the hypothesis that is chosen after the process of elimination, is clearly not deduced from or demonstrated on the basis of the phenomena. Yet insofar as the exclusion procedure has proceeded with care and scientific rigor, by means of what Bacon called winding and intricate processes, the conclusion, though not actually absolutely certain, is neither unwarranted nor uncertain. Bacon did face the following issue. Occasionally, the intellect, he says, is poised in equilibrium and cannot decide to which of two or occasionally more natures, that is theories, it should attribute or assign the cause of the nature under investigation. So occasionally, the scientist is faced with a choice between two alternatives, two competing hypotheses. Famously, Bacon thought the scientist should look for what he called crucial instances, which stand a good chance to break the deadlock in favor of one hypothesis over its competitors. Now, these crucial instances might not be easy to find at all. Occasionally, it takes keen and constant diligence to unearth them, as Bacon put it. Still, there is no compelling reason to think that they are not in principle available. When it comes to Descartes, it was on the other side of the debate. Descartes has no room for induction, of course. His conception of demonstration, however, was not quite Aristotelian syllogistic proof. Rather, it was more akin to what we nowadays call explanation. As he put it, there is a big difference between proving and explaining. Now, Descartes' key thought was that in order to understand the world, the mind somehow should restrict the empirical models of the world via what he thought are metaphysically necessary principles known as laws of nature. Actually, Descartes was probably the first to talk about laws of nature, and he thought that the fundamental laws of nature are kind of knowable a priori, based as they are on the immutability of God. However, within this framework, which is constrained from above with a priori necessary laws of nature, empirical science and hence empirical knowledge is actually possible, because then we can use and we should use hypotheses and experiments to fill in the details. We cannot find out what the world is like in its less fundamental structure unless we use hypotheses and experiments according to Descartes. He too, however, thought that you might have competing systems of hypotheses, that is, theories which say different things about a phenomenon and somehow get the very same evidence in its support. So the example he used to illustrate this possibility was the case of an artisan who produced two clocks, which indicate the hours equally well. They are extremely similar and yet work with different internal mechanisms. How do you choose if you are faced with this situation? Now, famously, Descartes, when he wrote his masterpiece, Principia Philosophica, 1644, he wavered between two thoughts, which became the standard approaches to how you solve the problem of underdetermination, as it were. The first thought, Descartes thought, was that it does not really matter which of the two competing hypotheses you choose, it does not really matter which of them is true, provided they both correspond accurately to all the phenomena of nature. So empirical adequacy is enough. Truth does not matter. However, at the same, a few sections later, he said what we nowadays call theoretical virtues, that is, simplicity, coherence, unity, naturalness, are the marks of truth, in the sense that it would be very unlikely, as he put it, that a theory possesses them and be false. Actually, what's very interesting is that Descartes put a premium on novel predictions, predictions of phenomena which are not of the kind already in support of the theory. When postulated causes explain phenomena not previously thought of, there is good reason to think they are their true causes. So novelty, novel empirical success, was for Descartes a mark of truth. In the closing paragraphs of the Principia, he noted that when it comes to science, only moral certainty is achievable and desirable. So what this historical excursion actually shows, if anything, is it's what I call a historical puzzle. The founders of the modern debate of scientific method, Descartes and Bacon, none of them actually thought that belief in the truth of a theory is justified only if the theory is proved to be true on the basis of the evidence or by the light of reason alone. So it is a bit of a puzzle how exactly the idea of empirical proof of a theory as the only way to justify the theory became a philosophical contender. Without this very idea of deductive underdetermination, the deductive underdetermination carries no epistemic weight whatsoever. But we can look at a little bit more carefully at some philosophical arguments why deductive underdetermination is no good. And the first argument is this. Theories entail observational consequences only with the aid of auxiliary assumptions. The available auxiliary assumptions may change over time. Hence, the set of observational consequences of a theory is not circumscribed once and for all. It is temporarily indexed. So even if for the time being, for any time t, two theories entail the same observational consequences, there may be future auxiliary assumptions such that when conjoined with one of them, they yield fresh observational consequences that can shift the evidential balance in favor of it over its rival. And here is a very interesting case which actually illustrates this. It's the discovery of planet Neptune. The so-called problem of Uranus was that the trajectory of the then recently discovered planet had proved to be intractable. Following Laplace's monumental calculations of the mutual perturbations exerted by the planets, the French astronomer Alexis Bouvard tried in 1821 to calculate the tables predicting the positions of the three giant planets, Jupiter, Saturn, and Uranus. Uranus's positions were not the ones predicted by the Newton-Laplace theory, even after taking into account the perturbations exerted by other planets. So the predicted motions of Uranus were the consequence of conjoining the Newton-Laplace theory with the auxiliary assumption that the possibly disturbing planets were seven. It was Alexis Bouvard himself who was the first to speculate that a new planet, Troublant, a disturbing planet, could cause the anomalous motion of Uranus. But it was Urbain Le Verrier who in 1846 took on the task to calculate the position and mass of the perturbing planet by means of the perturbations exerted on Uranus. So the logical structure of the problem was the following. Given a new auxiliary assumption, a new perturbing planet, would it still follow that the trajectory of Uranus would be anomalous? Mathematically, the problem was the inverse. That is, to use the perturbations as given and to calculate the positions and mass of the planet that would cause them if it were there. This involved some significant simplifications, for instance, that the distance of the planet from the Sun is known. But in his presentation to the Academy of Science on 1st June 1846, Le Verrier could confidently announce, "I conclude also that one can effectively model the irregularities of Uranus's movements by the action of a new planet placed at a distance of twice that of Uranus from the Sun, and that is just as important that one can arrive at the solution in one way only." The uniqueness of the region was a significant result, even though there was still considerable uncertainty about the planet's exact location, since it shows that the interplay between theory and evidence can lead to considerable narrowing down of the theoretical space of possible alternatives. In the night of the 23rd-24th September 1846, the astronomer Johann Gottfried Galle in the Berlin Observatory discovered the perturbing planet. A few other astronomers actually observed it a few days later, and two science journals announced the discovery. The planet was called Neptune, a name proposed by Le Verrier. A second argument against deductive underdetermination is that theories may get support from pieces of evidence that do not belong to their observational consequences. So not only do you get extra observational consequences by further auxiliary assumptions, but you get support from non-observational consequences by evidence which is not implied by the theory. There is another famous case here, and it's continental drift, which initially proposed by Alfred Wegener. According to the theory as it was later developed, when tectonic plates move across the surface of the Earth, they carry the continents with them. The proposed theoretical mechanism for this is seafloor spreading. The idea is this: molten magma from beneath the surface of the Earth rises and breaks the Earth's crust in certain weak places. A place that is typically happens is a spreading ridge, that is a gap in the sea, in the seabed, which is widening as the tectonic plates move apart. The magma that fills these gaps cools and hardens, thereby pushing all the rock aside as new seafloor is created. Now, if this theory is right, there must be spreading ridges to be found in the oceans. And indeed, the largest of all these ridges is the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, which runs north to south down the length of the Atlantic Ocean. But that's a prediction from the theory. What's extremely interesting is that there is evidence outside the theory. And this is the so-called magnetic stripping. So minerals that contain iron in the magma align themselves with the magnetic field of the Earth as the magma cools. But, it is well known, the orientation of the Earth's magnetic field changed polarity many times over history. Actually, this is something evidence for which became available fairly recently, that is around 1960. It would therefore be expected that the rocks that make the seabed would exhibit a pattern of polarity reversals from normal polarity to reverse polarity, depending on the polarity they recorded when they cooled. And actually, you can see the pattern over there. This is exactly what was observed by scientists using magnetometers at spreading ridges. So that's a triumph of the theory from evidence which is not quite entailed by it. Let's now take a look at what I call inductive underdetermination. The thought here is that the evidence can never render a theory probable. The very possibility of inductive underdetermination requires taking for granted that any attempt to prove the theory on the basis of the evidence is futile. So there shouldn't be deductive underdetermination if there is to be inductive underdetermination. Still, it is argued, no evidence can confirm a theory or make it probable than before, or more probable than before, the evidence was made available, or no evidence can inductively confirm a theory more than its rivals. How can that be? The claim of inductive underdetermination presupposes that the very idea that the same body of evidence can confirm two theories to different degrees is either incoherent or bankrupt. Why do I say that? That's a bold claim. I say that because on any extant theory of confirmation, any theory at least that I know of, the evidence can render a theory probable or more probable than its rivals. That is, on any theory of confirmation that we have available, the evidence can raise the probability of a theory or can raise the probability of a theory more than the probability of its rivals. So, For inductive underdetermination to be plausible, it must rest on some arguments that question the very idea that evidence can play a confirmatory role vis-a-vis the theory. Can there be such arguments? Now, there is an argument in the literature, the zero prior probabilities argument, and it capitalizes on the fact that no evidence can affect the probability of the theory unless the theory is assigned some non-zero initial probability. But if inductive underdetermination rested on the claim that all prior probabilities are zero, it would simply be inductive skepticism. And I know of no one else who has aimed to support this view except Popper. Now, given that two rival theories are assigned different prior probabilities, the evidence can confirm one more than another or even make one highly probable. The challenge faced by philosophers is the following: where do these prior probabilities come from? More particularly, how can prior probabilities have any epistemic force? There is a dilemma here, or an oscillation between subjectivism on the one hand and the project of the failed project of inductive logic on the other. So subjective Bayesians typically argue that in the long run, the prior probabilities wash out. Even widely different prior probabilities will converge in the limit to the same posterior probability if agents conditionalize on the same on the same evidence. There's a technical device called Bayesian conditionalization, which guarantees that no matter what you start with, whatever prior probability you start with, if you conditionalize on the evidence, if you use Bayes' theorem to update your degrees of belief, then you're going to converge in the long run in the same posterior probability. It's a cliche now, but Keynes used to say, in the long run, we're all dead. So in the end, you know, can we wait until the long run to find out what whether we're going to converge on the same posterior probability? So this move, though true, it is restricted to very specific cases, and it offers little consolation. So what is the alternative? If you don't like subjective Bayesianism, what is the alternative? To claim that prior probabilities can and do have epistemic force because they express rational degrees of belief, based, for instance, on plausibility or explanatory judgments. Now, the challenge faced by the thought I just expressed, which I very much like, is this. Can this be done? Can we argue about plausibility and explanatory judgment influencing prior degrees of belief without going for a logic of induction? Now, it's a long story. The logic of induction occupied the minds of many philosophers and logicians in the 50s and 60s and 70s, but it went bankrupt as a logic. So everybody agrees now that there is no such thing as a logic of induction, but I claim it does not follow from the failures of the logic of induction that there cannot be rational grounds for assigning objective that is ultimately intersubjective and not purely idiosyncratic initial degrees of plausibility to competing theories. All that is required is relying on various causal eliminative considerations, which are of the sort that make scientists take a theory seriously as subject to further exploration and test. The second type of argument that questions the very idea that evidence can play a confirmatory role vis-a-vis the theory rests on the claim that theories that purport to refer to unobservable entities are unconfirmable. That's a very strong position. There are people who hold this position. But if you think of it, this would be a kind of a selective inductive underdetermination, implying that evidence can confirm theories about observables, but it somehow fails to confirm theories about unobservables. But this selective inductive underdetermination has a bite only if the methods that lead to and warrant belief in observable entities and observational generalizations are different from the methods that lead to and warrant belief in theories that posit unobservable entities. Yet the methods that scientists use are exactly the same. In particular, both when it comes to observables and when it comes to unobservables, explanatory considerations play an indispensable role in forming scientists' belief about the theories they accept. There is a very strong argument in the literature which is called the idea that there can be totally empirically equivalent theories. Theories such that they entail exactly the same observational consequences under any circumstances. There is a very well-known thesis in the philosophy of science called the Duhem-Quine thesis. Quine is lumped together with Duhem, or Duhem is lumped together with Quine. Historically, that's unjustified, but that's a very popular position, which has been suggested as an algorithm for generating empirically equivalent theories. So here how the argument goes. We start with the undeniable premise that all theories entail observational consequences only with the help of auxiliary assumptions. We already used this premise in the case of Uranus. And conclude that it is always possible that a theory, together with suitable auxiliaries, can accommodate any recalcitrant evidence. A corollary of this argument is that for any evidence, and any two theories, T and T prime, there are suitable auxiliaries, A and A prime, such that T and prime and A will be empirically equivalent to T and A prime. Hence, it is argued no observational evidence can tell two theories apart. Now, that's a very popular argument, but it is well known that there is no proof that non-trivial auxiliary assumptions can always be found. But suppose, for the sake of the argument, that we accept that it is true, that we can always find auxiliary assumptions, we can save a theory from refutation. What does it show? Not much, actually. From the alleged fact that any theory can be suitably adjusted so that it resists refutation, it does not follow that all theories are equally well confirmed by the evidence. The empirical evidence does not necessarily lend equal inductive support to two empirically concurrent theories, since it is not necessarily the case that the auxiliary assumptions that are needed to save a theory from refutation will themselves be well supported by the evidence. And here is a nice example. You don't know Vulcan, probably. Vulcan does not exist. But around 1850, everybody in astronomy and Newtonian mechanics knew that there is a problem with Mercury's orbit. The orbit of planet Mercury was anomalous. It was predicted an ellipse, of course, by Newton's laws, by Kepler's laws, but the observed orbit was not quite the ellipse. The case was made famous as the anomalous perihelion of Mercury. So here we've got a case which is prima facie similar to the case of Neptune. We've got a prediction from the theory together with auxiliary assumptions, and the thought is that the observed trajectory of Mercury is not the one predicted by the Newton-Laplace theory. But even with modified auxiliaries, by taking account of the perturbations by other planets, most significantly by Venus, the anomalous perihelion was not accounted for. One interesting modification of auxiliary assumptions concerned the mass of Venus. If the mass of Venus was larger by 10% of its actual mass than what was taken to be the actual mass, this very fact would explain Mercury's anomaly. But if actually Venus had this kind of extra mass, it would perturb the motion of the Earth too, and the motion of the Earth would not actually be the one that it is predicted. So this new auxiliary assumption could be independently tested. If, as I said, the mass of Venus were larger, then the perturbations caused by Venus in the orbit of Earth would be inadmissibly large. So here is a plausible thought by Le Verrier. What if we posit an extra planet? A planet, or if one prefers, a group of smaller planets circling in the vicinity of Mercury's orbit, would be capable of producing the anomalous perturbation felt by the latter planet. According to this hypothesis, the mass sought should exist inside the orbit of Mercury. So, like the case of Neptune, a new planet was posited, which, if it were present between Mercury and the Sun, if it had the right mass, it would perturb Mercury's motion enough to account for the anomalous perihelion. Though Le Verrier had doubts about the existence of such a planet, there were some reported sightings of it, and he came to accept its existence. He called it Vulcan. But this new auxiliary hypothesis, which would save Newton's theory from refutation, could be independently tested. You could actually try and observe the planet. And further observations made showed the presence of no such planet. Actually, the solution is very radical. The anomalous perihelion of Mercury had to wait for its solution, the advent of Einstein's general theory of relativity and the essential revision of Newton's theory of gravity. So evidence can tell theories apart, but evidence does not speak with the voice of an angel, nor does it operate in a theoretical and axiological vacuum. Perhaps the most important lesson that can be drawn from the discussion of the Duhem-Quine problem is that the thought that there is an algorithmic relation between theory and evidence is totally bankrupt. Evidence plus logic are not enough even to decide when a theory should be abandoned or modified. And that's one book, La Théorie Physique, son objet, sa structure, the physical theory, its object and its structure by Pierre Duhem. If you have to read, if you are able to read just one book of philosophy of science in your life, this should be the book that you should read. It was published in 1906. It's as if it was published yesterday. And it's really an important, the most important philosophy of science book written ever, according to my view. In this seminal book, I'll say what the gist is, but to think what the problem is, think of the case of Vulcan and Neptune. They are structurally the same. They have exactly the same conceptual structure. They are both about bringing Newton's theory in line with anomalous trajectories of planets. And yet, in the Neptune case, we have a triumph of Newton's theory. It's a success story. Whereas in the Mercury case, we have a failure of the theory. We have to revise the theory to account for the anomalous perihelion of Mercury. I claim no algorithmic account of the relation between evidence and theory can present both moves as rational. But they are both rational, although different solutions to a conceptually similar problem. Now, what Duhem actually observes is that, actually, that's a point made prominent by another famous philosopher of science of the turn of the 20th century, Henri Poincaré, that there is a difference between actually contradicting a theory, that is, producing a contradictory instance, and condemning a theory. So a theory can be condemned without being actually contradicted by the evidence. Duhem is very famous for actually denying the very idea of crucial experiments. He famously said they're impossible in physics. You can always save a theory technically from refutation, if you like. If a situation such as this is not possible, how do theories get abandoned? How can a theory be condemned without being disproved by the evidence? Any answer would have to go beyond the strict limits of evidence and logic. What Duhem suggested, not for the first time, but he was probably the first systematizer of this thought, is that when scientists think about how to choose between theories, they appeal to what has now been termed the usual suspects, the so-called theoretical virtues, the scope of the theory, the number of hypotheses, the nature of hypotheses, novel predictions. Duhem was a famous advocate of novel predictions as a way to tell theories apart, compatibility with other theories, unification into a single system of hypotheses. Yet another very important advocate of unification. Now, these are values or virtues that a theory may or may not have, and as such, they transcend logic. At least they defy a rigorous logical formulation. What Duhem clearly saw was that the employment of such criteria or virtues is A, indispensable, and B, not algorithmic. Their employment requires the exercise of judgment by scientists. Actually, Duhem spoke about this bon sens, the good sense, which is something that scientists acquire via their training, and they make the right choices in the end, okay? But that's kind of ineffable. That's something that it passed on from generation to another generation by just training, okay? Not a theory of a good sense. And though the reasons of good sense do not impose themselves with the same implacable rigor as the prescription of logic do, they are still reasons. Duhem actually was a great admirer of Pascal. For him, these reasons are reasons which reason does not know. So I want to claim that judgment is a part of the scientific method. Sometimes people associate with the great Rudolf Carnap the idea of a robot. It's like a machine. You've got the experimental evidence coming in. There are some calculations, in the robot, and then a degree of confirmation comes out. Okay, and somehow this is something that can become more or less algorithmically. There is no such thing as Carnap's robot. That's a fiction. Does it follow from the judgmental character of the method that the criteria that guide these movements are unreasonable, unknowable, unworkable, subjective, opaque? I think none of the above actually follows. What we should do, we should take to heart Duhem's lesson. Scientific method is not algorithmic. It requires the exercise of judgment. This judgment is constrained by evidence as well as by several virtues that the theories may or may not possess. It can be rational even if it's not dictated by evidence plus logic. Its rationality depends ultimately on taking account of the reasons that favor a certain option and condemn another. But we may be able to go beyond Duhem. A theory of rational judgment is not doomed from the start. It cannot be reduced, or it should not be reduced, just to an ineffable good sense. A good starting point for such a theory is to focus on the role that explanatory considerations and virtues of theories play in rational judgment, a point that Duhem himself made available back in 1906. There is an emerging thought in the, actually it's not an emerging thought, I mean it's a popular thought, I mean it's, there is some revival of this thought recently, but it's a very popular thought that, which says that social values actually are involved in science, not only descriptively, but normatively, they ought to be appealed to in the solution of underdetermination problems. So most people who talk about these social values take underdetermination for granted. I don't want to take underdetermination for granted. I think it's a bit of a red herring. But people think that because we should take it for granted, we should appeal to social virtues actually to break under, you know, evidential ties, underdetermination problems. Now, what are epistemic values? What are social values? That's a huge question. I don't have a definite answer to that. I take epistemic values which, at least under favorable circumstances, could or would be related to the probability of a theory being true. So we don't know whether the world is simple. The world might be extremely complicated, but if the world is simple, a simple theory has a better chance to be true than a complicated theory. So at least under very favorable circumstances, this value, this epistemic value, is reflected on the degree of probability of the theory. Social values, on the other hand, are values whose raison d'etre, as it were, are social or ideological or moral or political considerations. Now, simplicity, coherence, explanatory power, novel predictive success are supposed to be epistemic values or virtues. Promoting the welfare of humanity, creating equal opportunities, respecting the moral rights of individuals are social values. But these are examples of good social values. And this is a key point. Not all social values are equally good. Nor is it the case that the goodness or badness of a social value is always written on its forehead, as it were. Nor worse is it the case that by calling a social value, it makes it valuable. So there are some arguments for the promotion of social values. I'm going to go through them quickly. The first argument is the so-called gap argument. We premise first evidence underdetermines theory, yet theory choice is not and should not be paralyzed in the face of underdetermination. Hence, social values fill the gap between evidence and theory and determine or partially determine theory choice. There is an immediate response to this. Even if we were to grant that evidence underdetermines theory, epistemic virtues can be appealed to in order to break observational ties. Hence, the response is, it is epistemic virtues, not social, that can and should determine theory choice. But there is a variant of the gap argument in the face of this reply, which says something like the following. An appeal to epistemic virtues is not enough as a tiebreaker, since one set of epistemic values might, or one assignment of weights to epistemic values, might favor one theory and another set of epistemic values might favor a rival theory. So there might be underdetermination even in the face of epistemic values. Hence the claim is social values might well, actually they should be appealed to in order to break ties between competing sets of or competing weight assignments to epistemic values. The other big argument is a so-called error argument. Science can never yield certainty, we know that. Hence, scientific theories can be erroneous despite the evidential support they might enjoy. That's true too. Yet theories are nonetheless accepted or rejected, and judgments of acceptance or rejection are dependent on decisions about how serious an error it is to accept a theory if it's false or rejected if it's true. These latter judgments are amenable to ethical and social considerations. Hence, theory acceptance is science is subject to social values. So these are the two most popular arguments. And a counter to these two arguments is this. people tend to grant the role of social value in scientific inquiry, broadly understood, but they relocate social values at a certain later stage of scientific inquiry, and in particular at the adjacent stage of policy making and decision making. The standard view is that social values are not supposed to offer reasons to believe a theory, but they do and should guide decisions about how to handle the uncertainty associated with the theory and how to employ the theory. The rationale for this conception of the role of values is that if social values are taken to play a role in theory acceptance, and hence if they give us reasons to believe a theory, the objectivity of science might be threatened. As a very good philosopher who is down the road, strictly speaking, Heather Douglas said, values are not evidence, wishing does not make it so. Who is right and why? Now, I'm a big fan of objectivity. Objectivity is important and makes science distinct and distinctive. But objectivity need not be value-free. Nor is it the case that objectivity requires an impossible algorithmic account of how evidence bears on theory. There cannot be such an account anyway. So the locus of objectivity is an inquiry in which evidence and epistemic values are in reflective equilibrium and mutual adjustment. Values influence our evidential judgments and play a role in filling the gap between the evidence and theory. Conversely, evidence influences our value judgments and plays a role in adjusting and refining values. In this interplay between values and evidence, the world, I think, is the final arbiter, in the sense that it is agreement with the way the world is that ultimately determines theory acceptance and choice. It is this ultimate determinant that safeguards the theories from being wishful thinking. In this mode of conceiving the relation between values and evidence, there is no issue of priority. Values and evidence get into the scientific inquiry at the same time, and they presuppose each other. This is constitutive of scientific inquiry. Here is a famous example, Newton's rule four of philosophizing. In experimental philosophy, we are to look upon propositions inferred by general induction from phenomena as accurately or very nearly true, notwithstanding any contrary hypothesis that may be imagined, till such time as other phenomena occur by which they may either be made more accurate or liable to exceptions. Now, in this very rule of scientific method, if you like, epistemic values play a prominent role. Newton makes clear that a proposition which has been inductively established has to be adhered to disregarding alternative hypotheses. But this last requirement is a value, not a statement of fact. Accuracy, looking for accuracy, is a value too. By disregarding alternatives until more accuracy is needed or recalcitrant evidence is found, the accepted proposition does not obviously become wishful thinking. After all, it is the product of induction, and hence it is supported by various natural phenomena. Can we run the same argument for social values? Here I would urge a lot more caution. Social values are socially determined values, occasionally even dictated by political, ideological, and class interests. And then the question immediately arises, and I think that's a very, very serious question to which I don't know the answer. Whose social values? The critics of the view that the social value ladenness of scientific judgment are right in stressing that social values might jeopardize rather than promote the objectivity of science, unless they are the right kind of values. But who is going to decide what are the right kind of values, of social values, and what not? Here is what we could think very vaguely. My friend Bill Harper will hate me, but I will say that, as the analog of Newton's rule four, the precautionary principle, which can be used somehow to say what research should be done in the face of uncertainty when human environmental degradation is a possibility. The precautionary principle is hugely debated. It says, when human activities may lead to morally unacceptable harm that is scientifically plausible but uncertain, action shall be taken to avoid or diminish that harm. And then it goes on to define morally unacceptable harm to harm made to humans or in the environment that is threatening to human life or health, serious and effectively irreversible, inequitable to present or future generations, or imposed without adequate consideration of the human rights of those affected. The judgment of plausibility should be grounded in scientific analysis. Now, here is a very nice case where social values are actually used explicitly in the formulation of a rule of how to assess scientific theories. So the precautionary principle embodies social values. The very idea of morally unacceptable harm to humans and to the environment captures a set of social values, the key element of which is that human life and environmental sustainability are intrinsically valuable and should take precedent over other possible social values, for instance, economic growth. What is important about the precautionary principle is that it can be justified as a principle only if the very social values that are embodied in it take precedent over other values, for instance, economic interests, or profit, etc. There is a very interesting case, the asbestos case. There is this disease, mesothelioma. It's a fatal disease with a very long incubation time, which once it is manifested, it is normally fatal within 1 year. It is now widely acknowledged by scientists that asbestos is the main cause of this disease. It is reported by health experts at about 250,000 to 400,000 deaths from mesothelioma, lung cancer, and asbestosis will occur over the next few decades in the European Union countries only, and as a consequence of exposure to asbestos in the past. The evidence for asbestos was already there, though not compelling, already in the 1960s, and according to a report, it contributed to the long delay before action was taken and risk reduction regulations was put in place. The evidence of harmful effects of asbestos was there in the middle 60s, but it was only in the 1990s that European Union banned all forms of asbestos. I'm not sure it's banned in Canada, actually. Now, but the idea, and that's a report by the World Commission on the Ethics of Scientific Knowledge and Technologies, is if asbestos was banned in 1965, in Holland only, about 34,000 victims of asbestos could have been spared. And 19 billion of euros, actually, which is quite a big. It would contribute a lot to helping Greece get out of the mess. Now, this suggests to me two things. First, there can be evidence for a principle such as the precautionary principle. That is evidence that speaks in favor of making it a general principle, even if social values are involved in it. And that's empirical evidence. Evidence coming from learning how we failed to act on the basis of this principle in the past and what the consequences were. So the choice of principles such as the precautionary principle can be based on evidence. Second, and more importantly, there can be no evidence for the social values themselves. There can be evidence for the principle, if you want the social values, do this, follow this principle, but not the social values themselves. Their choice is not a matter of evidence, let alone of an instrumental justification. The choice has to do with the way we conceive ourselves as human beings and the moral and social implications of our conceptions. A resistance to PP, I take it, is based at least to a large extent on a different set of social values, where, for instance, possible harm to the environment is traded off to actual economic growth and profit. Who is going to decide what are the right kind of social values and what not? I'm not sure how to answer this question, but my attitude is this. The way forward, I would suggest, is that there should be ways to show how otherwise perspectival social values can become universal. The idea of universalizability of a certain set of social values is, for all practical purposes at least, their objectivity. I think the best bet so far are standpoint epistemologies, where in the way I understand them at least, the standpoint, and hence the values, of a certain socially identified group aims to become the universal standpoint from which society and its structure and viewed and values are viewed. It is only by means of this strong objectivity perspective that social values in science can be fully congenial to its objectivity. Let me say a few more words and I'm gonna be done. Now, how did this happen? You know, the press, scientific journals, the scientists are full of publications about the government of Canada curbing evidence, etc., etc. How does all this relate to the death of evidence debate in Canada? Now, I was trying to find arguments in the press or in magazines about against the case of the war on science, and the best I could get was from a former head of Canada Statistics, Philip Cross, I think. I'm not going to go through all of it, but argument number three is quite important. Research should be directed to more commercial ends, and the Harper administrator wants to do this. And second, science relates to economic growth, and the impediments to economic growth, such as the science underpinning environmental regulation, should be reduced or eliminated. These are serious arguments why curbing scientific evidence is apparently justified. There is another argument I'm going to skip about the failures of science. We can discuss it. That's a final thing. What is the conception of the value of science tacitly implied by these arguments? Science is subordinate to various social, political, and economic interests. Hence, when there is a conflict between science and the dominant social values, it should be science that has to yield. That's the dominant, that's a conception implied by the arguments I just mentioned. This is not a new ideological conception of science and its value. What seems to be new in Canada is the way this conception of science is affected. That is by curbing the sources of data and evidence on which science thrives. If you want to kill a plant, you can cut off its roots. It might not be the most efficient way to do it, but it is the surest. We see here in action evidence for the claim that though science is not free of social values, it matters a lot what these values are and whose values they are. What is ultimately at stake in the value of evidence, in the death of evidence debate in Canada, is the value of evidence in science and in public life. Therefore, the title of my talk, Evidence Should Always Be Wanted, Alive or Dead. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Psillos. Helena Lipornik, do you want to start? Okay.
Thank you very much, Professor Psillos. I really enjoyed your paper and your talk as well. I thought it was beautifully set up and a really great overview of kind of the history of philosophy of science and the relationship between logic and evidence to the scientific method. So as Brian said at the outset, my interest in terms of my research is specifically in statistics, and my comments relate to probability. And I, in general, think that more could be said about probability in your paper, which tends to focus mostly on logic, sort of the binary true or false logic and its relationship to evidence. And I think probability can offer a lot in terms of our understanding of the scientific method. So there are two specific spots in the paper in terms of the setup that I thought might benefit from more consideration of the role of probability. The first was, I was wondering in your discussion of inductive underdetermination, you talk about the fact of non-zero priors and go straight into this idea of washing out priors. But it seems to me that some discussion would be warranted here about the prior probability of 0.5. So there is a notion of indifference or agnosticism, which I think plays a large role in many scientific questions. And if we're going into an inquiry with a 0.5 or an indifferent assessment of whether two competing hypotheses are true, then you don't run into the problem of washing out of the priors because you've started from that perspective. So it seemed to me that something useful could be said there in that setup in terms of the possibility of the indifference. And this reminded me of something that I read in the Scientific American blog yesterday, actually, about it was actually a commentary on Dr. Isis in a discussion about scientific hypotheses. And Dr. Isis is a physiologist, and she was talking about a fellow who came to see her and brought a draft of a paper. And the paper started out by saying, to the best of our knowledge, this phenomenon that they were going to investigate has never been reported in the literature. And that was sort of how the fellow was framing the physiological problem. And Dr. Isis had two major problems with this formulation. The first was, she said, everything is always to the best of our knowledge. You should never have to say that. You can just say it's not reported in the literature. And then her second complaint, which is somewhat tangential, is that that something has never been reported in the literature is a terrible reason to investigate a problem. You know, the fact whether I wore black underwear this week or not is also something that's never been reported in the literature, and it's probably something that shouldn't ever be. But the point is just that the point is just that indifference and a sort of wisdom of knowing what you don't know is often the perspective with which scientists approach a problem, and I think it should be given more consideration possibly. So what about the agnostic approach to two competing hypotheses? So that was my first point. The second, slightly more serious area where I think probability could be useful in terms of the setup of the problem is in understanding how judgment and common sense play a role in the scientific method. So one way of conceiving that what's going on is something beyond just evidence and logic is that there are prior probabilities, prior beliefs with which the scientist goes in with when looking at a specific problem. So that is while obviously scientists sometimes come to their work and approach a hypothesis with a prior probability of 0.5, that is, they're completely indifferent as to whether it is certainly true or certainly false. That's certainly not always the case, and in many cases it actually seems that any coherent explanation of what's going on when people practice science requires a role for prior probabilities. My favorite illustration of this comes from a Libosivi article that was published in 2001 in the British Medical Journal. So this is a really serious medical journal taken very seriously, peer-reviewed and so on. And the title of the paper was 2001, this is recently, effects of remote, retroactive, intercessory prayer on outcomes in patients with bloodstream infection, a randomized controlled trial. So yes, you heard me correctly. I said remote, so the people praying were elsewhere. Intercessory, meaning it was an intervention the prayer was supposed to affect. And the most important part, it retroactive. So here we had people praying for patients. The patients had been in the hospital between 1990 and 1996, and it was in 2000 that they were prayed for. And it was a randomized trial. He took 3,500 records from a particular hospital. He randomly assigned the records to the control group and the intervention group, and then a prayer was said for one group and not the other, and he came out with statistically significant results. So hilariously, a lot of people took this very seriously, and Libosivi actually had to publish a very kind to his commentators, I think, response saying that this was a light-hearted sort of article meant to make a very important point about explanatory mechanisms, certainly about values outside of just logic and evidence in science. But another way of conceiving of this is in terms of prior probabilities, I would say. My prior probability and probably most of our prior probabilities when considering the hypothesis that really any action taken now could affect outcomes that occurred in the past is pretty much as close to zero as we can get in this world. And that says something about why a single study, even if it has 3,500 patients in it, and even if it is a randomized controlled trial, which is the gold standard, isn't going to be enough to bring me from that almost zero probability to anything approximating belief in the truth of this effect. So really my point is just that I think probability plays an important role in beyond just the black and white binary of logic in understanding what goes on with the scientific method, and can do a lot to inform and understand the other aspect of what's going on. And I think Maya will speak to the social values aspect, so hopefully that gives her a little setup. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And now Maya Goldenberg. And then Stathis, we'll ask you to respond to both afterwards. Okay.
Okay. I want to speak to, Helena was right, I do want to speak to the question of social values, specifically the question raised about whose social values. Professor Psillos, thank you for your talk. It's my pleasure to comment on it. You raised the Canada's death of evidence controversy for the attention that it calls to the role and the value of evidence in science. The case highlights the damaging epistemic stagnation that occurs when good evidence is suppressed or research is compromised. He also paid attention to social constructivist tendencies in the past 50 or more years in philosophy of science to suggest that philosophers of science have been complicit in undermining the once prominent role of evidence in scientific reasoning, specifically the attention that's been paid to the underdetermination thesis and to the relationship between science and social values have delimited the justificatory role that evidence plays in theory selection. And now the worry is that we may be left with no means for rationally justifying our scientific claims. And that's a concern we need to address. Professor Psillos maintains that we need the right social values in order to sustain objectivity in science, but wonders who gets to say which values are right. I want to suggest that there are promising lines of philosophical research that Professor Psillos can draw from in order to acknowledge the relationship between science and non-epistemic values without falling into epistemic relativism. So the first area that I'd like to focus on is the evidence-based medicine debate within the philosophy of medicine. And the second, I want to draw from feminist philosophy of science, which has put considerable focus on the science-values relationship in the past few decades of scholarship. Now, both of these areas are invested in maintaining the epistemic status, the strong epistemic status of evidence and the normativity of science, even with this play of social values present. So I want to talk a little bit about how they propose to do that. So I'll start with evidence-based medicine. This is the, on the slide you'll see the most well-known definition of evidence-based medicine. So in medicine, the prolific evidence-based medicine movement put evidence at the forefront of good clinical practice. Its founders, who were clinical epidemiologists from McMaster University, initially suggested the implausible position that clinical trial evidence could direct patient care. Now, critics of evidence-based medicine, coming mainly from the medical humanities, were quick to malign this problematic positivist underpinnings of this new philosophy of medicine. They schooled the movement's enthusiasts on the value-ladenness of science and the underdetermination of theory by the evidence. All the while, those critics did not want to give up on evidence in favor of an approach to clinical reasoning that relies on hunches or received wisdom. And so philosophers of medicine have worked towards maintaining evidence's rightful place in clinical reasoning, one that respectfully recognizes the limits of evidence without denying the epistemic strength that evidence legitimately offers. So evidence-based medicine's movements somewhat trumpeted claims about providing the best evidence for optimal patient care prompted some healthy reflection within medicine and medical studies regarding how evidence is derived and how it is applied to the clinical setting. And critical investigation was directed towards medicine's epistemic grounding in the biomedical sciences, which provides its evidence base. The presumed highly rational application of clinical evidence to patient care was recognized to be far from obvious. It needed for more explication. So reflections on the nature of clinical reasoning have resulted in, I'm sort of drawing from a wide body of literature, but it's resulted in sort of a nuanced understanding of this process of clinical reasoning as an interpretive activity against the sort of simplistic evidence-based formulary of applying relevant trial evidence to individual patient care. The physician who's faced with producing accurate diagnostic, prognostic, or clinically appropriate treatment recommendations instead engages in a complex process of gathering information from a plurality of sources, assigning relevance to them, and synthesizing those inputs in order to come to a reasonable and well-reasoned conclusion. Sandra Tannenbaum refers to this final product as an interpretive story. Now, this interpretive story, it needs to be coherent. The conclusion must fit with the informational inputs. But it's a story nonetheless, because the gaps in the logic of evidence must be filled with interpretive content. It's been pointed out that even a sophisticated decision-making tool, and there are many options out there, while it can be helpful in ruling out certain options or highlighting missing information, it really can't guide the cognitive integration of such qualitatively diverse inputs as patient histories, epidemiological data, lab test results, patient preferences. Somehow those all need to come together in some sort of fantastic synthesis. So for this, in order to do that, we need the contribution of clinical judgment or practical wisdom, despite this knowledge being partial, bias-prone, and non-systematic. Now, that's not to say that there's no rational account here. These interpretive accounts can be strengthened so as to avoid bias by following certain rules of argumentation, but still some commentators have despaired over perceived inescapable subjectivism in clinical reasoning. One commentator, a psychiatrist, published a reflection in a medical journal that was tellingly titled, "Whose Evidence? Lessons from the Philosophy of Science." And in it, he construes those lessons to be that clinical reasoning is a political battle over whose value-laden evidence gets to count. The author assumes that there are no grounds for making justified clinical decisions without the previous security of the objectivist account of evidence that evidence-based medicine purportedly offered. Now, this speaks to the common view, and I think Professor Psillos holds this too, that there is no means for legitimate negotiation of the social or non-epistemic values that enter into science. And I want to challenge this view as I turn to the second area of philosophical investigation, which is feminist philosophy of science. So a little background where feminists come into philosophy of science. Feminist epistemologists of science, especially of the feminist empiricist strain, they frequently deploy the underdetermination thesis to reveal the play of values in scientific reasoning. So you're right that they do take underdetermination for granted, but they don't take it to the conclusion that therefore no theory can be justified. Instead, they open it up to, well, then let's talk about what values are actually allowing us to justify our claims. They interpret the thesis to describe a gap between evidence and theory acceptance that is filled by social and political values. But like the evidence-based medicine critics, feminists, philosophers of science are not satisfied to conclude that no theory can be justified because they are invested in protecting the normativity of science. Feminist theorists want to be able to criticize sexist science on normative grounds, and they can't do that if they start permitting a relativist account of values. So feminist scholars have been heavily invested in science studies because of the high socio-political stakes of knowledge production. As many of us know, women have historically suffered many exclusions in the name of science. For instance, biological and psychological explanations of women's supposed cognitive, emotional, and moral inferiority to men. So epistemic relativism is unacceptable within this framework. Feminists need to be able to demarcate good science from bad science to explain the problem of gender bias in many research protocols. And so feminist theorists have produced various reconfigured accounts of objectivity. They've reclaimed the notion of objectivity that's no longer a property of value-free science. Instead, values, even non-epistemic values, can enable good science and justified decisions. And I'll say a little more about how they do that. So a lot of feminist empiricists are influenced by Quine's holism and by his naturalized approach. So they've committed to the view that social values are inseparable from scientific reasoning. And that's both in the context of discovery and in the context of justification. Yet they'll insist that epistemic relativism is not a necessary consequence. Instead, the worrisome biasing effect that the inclusion of social values can bring to scientific reasoning is mediated through a communal approach, specifically by facilitating critical arbitration of competing values within democratically organized, diverse scientific communities. Scientific objectivity is grounded in this intersubjective process. Objective knowledge is produced through the critical interrogation by this ideal epistemic community of the background assumptions supporting competing theories. And the composition of the scientific community is crucial for promoting objectivity. Diversity is supposed to ensure that all stakeholders are represented, especially marginalized perspectives that can bring unique insight into, say, unfair background assumptions or the methodological limits of a given research protocol that stands to impact that marginalized community differentially. Democracy ensures that those marginalized perspectives receive uptake even when more powerful interests reside within the same epistemic community. So with this process that's been called transformative criticism by the philosopher Helen Longino, competing non-epistemic values can be evaluated, negotiated, and finally accepted or rejected. So against that fear of the fear of value-free science proponents, accepting the place of social values in scientific reasoning doesn't mean that anything goes or that the most powerful interests trump. Instead, this intersubjective evaluation holds the promise of getting us closer to the right social values that Psillos and others want for science. Those right values are determined by an inclusive epistemic community rather than the power interests getting to decide. So by this feminist account, science can be objective via its attention to the rules of evidence as well as the critical negotiation of competing values. So that's probably the most common feminist empiricist account of evidence and objectivity. But there are some reasons to be dissatisfied with this process. For one, justifying scientific claims just got harder because the standard for applying evidence to resolve concrete problems is no longer merely empirical adequacy, as the objectivists would have it, but also a range of epistemological virtues and social values that our sciences should be promoting. Numerous ways to challenge scientific findings open up and place a heavy burden on researchers to demonstrate the integrity of their value-laden scientist claims. Second, this new sense of objectivity is far from what most of us mean by the term. This feminist account of objectivity that I have described is grounded in scientific modes of inquiry. Objectivity is more commonly taken to refer to the truth and referential character of scientific theories, something that allowing for more points of view within the scientific community has limited ability to ensure. And finally, this account assumes an impoverished view of values. I want to focus on that. I want to propose that a better account of values can address some of the concerns regarding constructivist science that Professor Psillos has articulated. So those who advocate value-free science do so because they understand values to be ideologically held and immune to rational evaluation. The feminist empiricist invocation of a community court of value arbitrators suggests a similar view that values are not amenable to the same empirical modes of inquiry as are factual statements. Yet, there are several feminist theorists, including myself, who have recently challenged that we can rationally evaluate the content of value judgments that inform science. That is, we can justify the right values in circumscribed scientific contexts. So one such philosopher is Elizabeth Anderson, who has proposed that non-epistemic values play an evidential role in science. Values have been under-theorized in feminist science scholarship, with a failure to notice that value judgments depend on factual claims. Therefore, values can serve as evidence in certain decision-making contexts. Anderson actually criticizes feminist theorists' frequent deployment of the underdetermination thesis, but she doesn't do so directly by challenging the plausibility of empirically equivalent competing theories. Theories as previous critics have forcefully done. Instead, she focuses on what is assumed about those non-epistemic values that may fill the gap between evidence and theory. She argues that underdetermination permits the scientists' use of political values to mediate the link between evidence and hypotheses in scientific inquiry, yet provides no criteria for differentiating legitimate from illegitimate deployment of those values. She finds no offerings of such criteria in the rigorous accounts of value-laden science that are available, so she offers her own. She proposes that social values are used illegitimately when they are deployed to drive inquiry to predetermined conclusions. This amounts to dogmatism. Many proponents of value-free science see this dangerous direction, but they err in thinking that this is the only way that values can operate in science. Instead, sociology of science research tells us that value-laden background assumptions are needed to guide scientific inquiry. The guidance is legitimate, according to Anderson, when those values are amenable to empirical testing and revisions. They thereby foster open-ended inquiry rather than determined conclusions. So importantly, background assumptions and social values are not exempt from rational evaluation. Both Sharon Clough and myself have argued that value judgments are subject to empirical support. I'll give you an example. Sexist values may rest on the empirical claim that on numerous empirical claims about women's inferior cognitive ability in comparison to men. And they are therefore testable and even revisable in light of experience. They are further subject to many of the same cognitive requirements that factual claims are held to, such as fruitfulness or defeasibility. Sexist values grounded in claims about women's comparative inferior abilities have been amply discredited by research, thereby suggesting that feminist values endorsing gender equality are epistemically superior to those sexist values. Feminist values, therefore, stand among the right values that should guide open-ended scientific inquiry into gender relations. So this brings me to Professor Psillos' concerns about the role of social values in science and his treatment of the death of evidence controversy in Canada. He claimed social values might jeopardize rather than promote objectivity in science unless they are the right kind of values, but the worry was who is going to decide what the right kind of social values are. Now, his position rested on the claim that one's choice of social values, say values that support the precautionary principle or reject it, is not a matter of evidence. He says there can be no evidence for the social values themselves. I agree that the choice does not need to rely on evidence. Indeed, no choice of social values or anything really needs to be informed by evidence, but the rational justification of a choice must be so supported. The expectation that a set of values will ground scientific claims and be convincing to others must have empirical support. So we can apply this to the death of evidence case study. Professor Psillos considers whether or not the Harper government is at war with science in its actions of muzzling environmental scientists and closing numerous important research facilities and libraries. He quickly reviewed the former Statistics Canada analyst Philip Cross's arguments that these actions do not represent a war on science. And you rightly concluded that Cross's arguments do not stand up to scrutiny. But this is why I think they don't hold up. Most of Cross's arguments are value statements that challenge widely accepted norms regarding the aims of research, especially publicly funded research. For instance, there are Robert Merton's influential norms of science. And now, while these norms have been contested on numerous occasions since they were first taken up in 1942, they have never been challenged on the grounds that the primary aim of science is to further economic growth, or that funders, even public funding bodies, have the right to control what findings are publicly communicated. So sure, it's Cross's prerogative to choose these values, but much more effort is required to convince others that those values warrant our endorsement. We therefore have little reason to accept his conclusion that there is no war on science. Cross's value statements stand on shaky empirical ground compared to Harper's critics, who can argue that the government's actions contravene well-grounded norms like disinterestedness and communalism. Now, Professor Psillos seemed to perceive some kind of impasse over the conflict of values, even though I think he's actually successfully done the work of demonstrating the weaknesses of one value set over another with respect to the death of evidence controversy. My conclusions about the empirical content of values are meant to permit legitimate investigation of which values have a place in scientific inquiry. Furthermore, by including value judgments within the realm of empirical inquiry, evidence can be construed holistically to include the factual claims that we typically ascribe to evidence, as well as the epistemic strength gained via empirically supported value statements. So in some ways, we could argue that evidence does confirm theory here. So to conclude, I agree with Professor Psillos that evidence should always be wanted. I wanted to add that the presence of social values need not and should not prevent that. Thank you.
So we'll give Stathis maybe 10 minutes to respond, and maybe less. We only have this one mic at the front, and we would like to open the floor to some questions. And how we're going to have to do this, I think, is ask our speaker and commentators to come to the front, and you can raise your question, and then we'll repeat it at the front because it can't be heard beyond this little umbrella right here, okay?
Where is your mic? These were wonderful comments. Thank you so much, really. I mean, I really appreciate the effort and the thoughtfulness of the comments. I'll start with Helena's comments. You're quite right. I mean, probability plays a crucial role, and I didn't want to hide that. On the contrary, what I wanted to say is, I mean, here's the context. There is this pervasive view that somehow underdetermination is rampant. We cannot do away with it, you know, either deductive or inductive. And if it's rampant, we've got either to suspend our judgment or introduce extra values which go beyond the scope of, you know, evidence and things like that. And I wanted to show that it's not. Either in its deductive version or in its inductive version, it's not. And you're quite right. When it comes to how scientists actually use their judgments, there's a whole array of judgments, from agnosticism to mild support, to full support, to mild agnosticism. So there's a range of probabilities, more or less, from 0 to 1. But what I wanted to focus on was the thought that somehow scientific theories are not confirmable. Okay, so this, I mean, because if you take any theory of confirmation, any probabilistic theory of confirmation, there are circumstances under which, favorable circumstances under which, evidence can confirm a theory, or it can confirm it more than another. Prior probabilities is a case in point, and explanatory considerations. So that's why I said on any account of confirmation I'm aware of, there is no really threat of underdetermination under favorable circumstances. So for underdetermination to be a really genuine problem, it must be the case that there are reasons somehow to say that theories are unconfirmable. And I know of two reasons like that, which I try to explore, you know, that probability is zero, so it doesn't go up no matter what, or unobservables being unobservables cannot be confirmed. But you're quite right that the logic of science, if we can use this term, is not just deductive logic, it's probability theory. And probability theory, you see, the problem with Bayesianism, if I may say so, which I don't quite like, is that in a certain sense, they think of themselves as producing a variant to inductive logic. So the prior probabilities are free starters, okay? God given, you know, you dreamt of it, you know, whatever, okay? Somehow you got the probabilities, and then you turn the handle of Bayesian conditionalization, you update, and you're home and dry in the long run. And this, in its own way, obscures the role of judgment, because the prior probabilities reflect judgments about the quality of a hypothesis, the explanatory worth of a hypothesis, and things like that. And I think we agree on that totally. So thank you very much for these wonderful comments. Now, Maya's comments, I'm speechless. I mean, that's really great. Both EBM, EBM is a great thing, evidence-based medicine. A friend of mine said, you know, all of a sudden we started to think that medicine should be based on evidence. What was it based on before, you know? And in a sense, it's a certain way to understand what evidence means, which is clinical trials, basically, the gold standards, okay? And it's quite right, I think, that clinical trials, I think, is the best way we've achieved so far to get as close as possible to a kind of a conclusive proof of a causal claim when the circumstances are favorable, but clearly there are issues like the history of the patients and things like that. So disregarding the historical record and things like that is not something that we should, or epidemiological studies and things like that. So the story is really more nuanced. Now, feminist epistemology, I'm in total agreement with the project, not with the perspective, you know, and actually I alluded to standpoint epistemologists, not so much to feminist empiricism, because I think what I've learned, and I think I wanted to say that quite explicitly, from Marxism and feminist standpoint theories, is that there is a way in which you can have a perspectival view of reality, which embodies your social values, but nonetheless make it universal, make it the point of view of everyone. And that's what Georg Lukács thought that Karl Marx was trying to do, and that's what Sandra Harding and other feminist epistemologists try to do with this strong objectivity standpoint epistemology. So I just wanted to make this point that to answer the question whose values you need to find an argument which would somehow show that your own values, the values you prefer, the values you put forward, are objectively better than the other values, as it were. They're universal values or universalizable values, values that can be actually adhered to and accepted by other groups other than your own group, and by other perspectives other than your own perspective. So it's far from me that science is value-free. Science is full of you know, epistemic and social values play in practice an important influence. I mean, think of, you know, how scientists nowadays struggle to get money for grants, okay? And somehow that's so important for everyone that they could even go out of their way to show that, to repress, if you like, you know, contrary evidence to show that somehow they get the right results. So my perspective, and I totally agree with you on this, is that there can be evidence for a lot of the content of the values. So there are reactionary values, values that talk about, for me, they are totally reactionary values, like sexist values, okay? And which are supposed to be based on scientific evidence. And you can debunk the scientific evidence and say it's bankrupt. But this addresses part of the problem, because this is a value, unfortunately, it's a bad value, but it's a value of a social group. So it's got to be addressed on its own, in its own terms, as a social value. Okay, and irrespective of the scientific evidence in favor or against it, it's an issue of having a kind of an impeachable value. And my worry was to find ways in which you can actually show that some values are impeachable. And I thought strong objectivity probably gives you a way to actually make a case for your values being better than other values. And to finalize, to make a final point, you're quite right in practice. Even when it comes to feminist epistemology, feminist empiricism, who I respect a lot, there is an issue of actually using the perspective of the marginalized groups and talking about different value frameworks in a democratic society. What I wanted to stress is that the issue of value, at least in the naive way I think of it, is an issue of values, really, because, I mean, unless we respect the rights and the perspectives of the marginalized groups, and we give them a voice in our society, And unless we organize our society in such a way, in a democratic way, that free speech and honest discussion about values is actually the case, we cannot actually have any result in terms of promoting the points of view or giving voice to the marginalized groups. So I'm pleading, and I think ultimately, that's a political statement. Ultimately, it's a matter of, you know, acting in favor of promoting, for instance, good social values against just the predominance of market, okay? Or just the predominance of a commercialized conception of scientific research. It's not a matter of, you know, so sometimes my worry is that if you just rely on the evidence and you try to make it objective just on the basis of the evidence, despite the best intentions of the feminist epistemologist, maybe sight is lost of the political issue that is involved in this, or maybe a class issue that is involved in it. So that's what I wanted to say. Thank you so much. They were really wonderful comments. I'm absolutely grateful to you. Thank you.
Don't go too far. Any questions for the speaker or the commentators? We now have a microphone.
Yeah. Thank you for this very interesting and exciting debate. I'm a physicist, but with my own discoveries, I went beyond the physics and I came to the realm of philosophy. So when actually you consider the need of evidence, there is the problem which I find in what we can really call evidence. So when we physicists watch something, measure something, we collect data. So what we can really call evidence is problematic. And I will give you an example. Sun. When we watch sun, when we measure, you know, what we see hydrogen and helium. And that's the fact. These are data. But our conclusion that sun is made of hydrogen and process creating energy from hydrogen to fusion by hydrogen to helium by fusion is wrong. Why is it wrong? Because data which are correct, we came to use for the theory, which is already 80 years old and which is now going to be challenged, if not only by me, by somebody else, but there is always already people who challenge the theory. And what we can clearly see by looking at the sun for nowadays technology, we see that it is liquid. We see that, but we are hypnotized by the present theory. And what is actually that liquid? It's liquid boiling lava. It's everywhere. We live on a liquid boiling lava body. Rocks are everywhere. They are cold and firm on the surface, but below the surface are liquid. And we are just a drop from the sun. So when we come to that point that we see something and we measure something and we have data, the very important thing is to distinguish when we can call data evidence for something. Because we can easily make mistake transforming data into evidence for something. Our ability to really understand data through history we were always failing. And the story about the flat earth, the story about the geocentric system, we always were seeing that at least we can see moon and sun, and they're round. So how we can come to conclusion that earth can be flat? And we see that at least moon and sun, considering that they're rotating around the earth, so that means that we must be rotating around something. So we have data, and we make wrong conclusions, and we transform data into the evidence. So that's the important point. Yes, we need evidence, but by how we can get to the point to say these data are evidence for something. And I did launch the debate, public debate, which named hollow boiling lava stars versus dark matter, because we didn't see that the fabric of the universe is rock. It's everywhere. And we are looking for something we can't find. But we are so smart that we pursue in the wrong direction. So I would really like to have opportunity to give some talk on that if it is possible, because with my contact with scientists, I couldn't find a response for this. They're not able to accept such a possibility that everything can be wrong. But I hope that you, people from the philosophy of science, can grasp that we were always dealing with the big changes after a few centuries. And now we are back into that point that we have to change everything we know. Thank you very much. I would like to hear your opinion.
Very briefly, I mean, that's a long question, big question, and very interesting. I cannot comment on the scientific facts, but it's a non-trivial question, really, what is evidence? And there is a very simple answer to that, which is not very informative, but it is popular among philosophers, not philosophers of science. Evidence is whatever we know. But of course, when philosophers of science think of evidence, they think of observations, experimental results, data, something which is actually you can see with your naked eye, more or less, or measurements by instruments. And this is a very restrictive account, if you like, of evidence, because when they see some, you know, scintillations in a cloud chamber, physicists could think that this is evidence for the presence of an electron or something like that. So I don't know how to answer this question. I think that's a serious question. All I want to add very briefly is this: that, you know, philosophers of science of the kind of I've been thinking about, Popper, Kuhn, maybe the Bayesians, have not really cared about the question of what is evidence. Is that they didn't very much care about what is evidence, but how we change beliefs when we come to accept something as evidence. So Popper says we try to falsify, Bayesians say we update by conditionalization, inductivists say we actually confirm the theories. So they've been really interested in belief change, belief revision in science, not on how, what counts as evidence. I mean, that's my best shot anyway, but my colleagues might want to say something too.
Are the people in the Canadian government ignoring sound science so that they could continue on with their ideology? Like, if the precautionary principle was to apply to the tar sands expansion, would they not cease what they're doing if native people are dying downstream, or if there's acid rain falling on Alberta and Saskatchewan? Like, if you know, people in Calgary were getting the drinking water messed up, or situations that would prove that behavior is happening, it's creating a moral hazard, I guess. So I'm wondering what you could say to your arguments, like point three, beyond the ad hominem attacks, would be because the government funds research, they have the ability to ignore the science that they do not like.
I think this argument that because government funds research, it should, you know, direct research or ignore various elements of this research, or worse, that the government scientists should actually be considered civil, you know, employees and should actually speak with one voice, I think that's ridiculous. For many reasons, funding the science or the research does not imply that you should or control the research. But when it comes to the government scientists, it's interesting. They've got a double role. Okay, they are citizens and scientists. They work, and they don't work for a firm. They work for an institution which is presumably is there to further well-being of the population. So they work for this institution, but at the same time they are on the receiving end of the results of this research, like we are not government scientists. So I think they've got, you know, a responsibility, of course, to do their own research freely and to be allowed to do that. And at the same time, they've got the responsibility to ask citizens to actually express their views about the findings of the results. Like I would have the, if I knew the results, I could actually, as a free citizen, express my view. So I don't see that's a good argument. But I'm new to Canada, so I'm still learning about Canadian politics and how things work in Canada. But to me, an issue that is really that really shows how values are really involved in the way we think, we conceive of ourselves and science, etc. Would it make a difference if I spoke about the Alberta sands as tar sands or oil sands? I think it would. The idea is that, people who say that they're oil sands, they give a kind of a nice gloss on it, okay? And the idea that people talk about them as tar sands show that there are some dire consequences by something like that. So I think that's a case where it shows how value-laden this debate really is.
Thank you so much for the talk. Like, I found it really interesting. I share in your desire to find good social values in science. I'm sort of wondering how that's actually practically possible, but it would be great. I guess my question is actually on a very particular part of your talk, which is when you go after your selective inductive and underdetermination, yeah, and also just inductive underdetermination in general. And you use the example of the Vulcan example in parallel with the Neptune example. So I guess I have two sort of issues with that. The first one is sort of minor, I guess. The first one is that I guess if I was a serious sort of Quine Duhem fan, couldn't I just say that the Vulcan hypothesis was not actually observationally equivalent? And it's not a really good example of how you can sort of defeat this type of underdetermination. And the reason why it's not observationally equivalent is because there's no Vulcan. Like, this is sort of like a trivial sort of way that I can say that's not a good example of the Quine Duhem thesis in action. And I guess related to that, and to tying it to sort of your selective underdeterminism, is it seems to me that, you know, you said that the problem with selective IU is that it assumes that the methodologies aren't sort of the same. But this is sort of an example where, you know, your argument for why Vulcan sort of refutes underdetermination is because we can go look for it. And then the problem is what people who are big fans of Quine Duhem in terms of unobservable posits of science is that we just can't do that. So I'm worried that your sort of like nice example actually hurts your argument against selective IU.
Yeah, well, that's a good point. I mean, the way I used the Vulcan example was mostly as an attempt to show that auxiliary assumptions can be independently tested. And of course, we can never be sure, if you like, that Vulcan is not there, okay? Vulcan, if they were there, it would be on the other side of the sun. And actually, to observe Vulcan, they waited for solar eclipses and things like that. So it might play games with us and hide, okay? So, but these are sometimes scenarios that philosophers take seriously to talk about serious underdetermination. You can always think of a hypothesis which, and I don't want to take them seriously because I think they are mostly philosophical dreams or philosophical scenarios. The Vulcan case, I used it mostly to show how you can actually you can abandon a theory even though it's not contradicted by the evidence, because actually, you know, there could be ways in which people could defend. Actually, there are Vulcan defenders nowadays if you look at the internet, apparently. Yeah. Okay, like there are flat earthers. The selective underdetermination issue is more interesting, and I see the problem, but I still feel, unlike others, that even when it comes to very mundane generalizations like all planets move in ellipses or all ravens are black, you don't generalize by just enumerating. You just use explanatory assumptions like this is the best explanation of why the ravens we've seen are all black and not some black and some white, and so it seems to me fundamentally explanatory considerations are involved in accepting all kinds of hypotheses. Some of them are more mundane than others, some of them are more down to earth than others, but I don't see a principal distinction between, there is a lot more to be said here. And I know there is a lot more to be said, okay? But you know, I stop here for the interest of time.
Thank you very much for that excellent talk and the wonderful commentaries. My question is about the precautionary principle. How do you respond to the criticism that the precautionary principle might lead to the conclusion that you can't do anything?
Yeah.
Because of how can you figure out, sort out the consequences for future generations? That can turn out to be a mug's game.
That's a very good point, too. I've been reading about that lately, so I'm not really, I'm not an expert, but it seems to me that there is this charge that it's kind of empty. How can you possibly tell what are the dangers? Now, that's why I think Maya's point was really very important about judgment and how you actually go beyond the data and use other pieces of information you might have about, say, a plausible mechanism for an effect happening or not happening. So the evidence is not conclusive, and that's why the precautionary principle takes action, but you don't stop there. You try somehow to tell some story about how, for instance, asbestos could cause all these things, and insofar as you know all this information, or at least you've got some information about possible causal mechanisms of how they could be further tested if more evidence comes available, shows, it seems to me, that it's not just a matter of, it's not as empty as it might sound. I understand the reservations that people might have because they might say, some people are extreme and say the precautionary principle would curb all kinds of research because how do you know the results of your... but if you see the framing of the principle, it's really cases in which they really matter to us, okay? They matter to us as humans, they matter to us as higher mammals, basically... the environment, our well-being, et cetera, et cetera. So it seems to me judgment and value should be used to address the issue. Okay.
Okay, so I actually have a question for Professor Goldenberg, if I may.
Absolutely.
So it's about adjudicating social values. And in particular, you said that one way that we should do this is by having democratically organized diverse scientific communities, right? And so my question is about where, and you also said that social values have empirical content. So my question is, if we have two different social values that are competing values, and they're both supported by the evidence, let's say, or they both have empirical context, so if in the example that you gave, women and men should be equal, fine, but let's say that's that one value competes with another value. I have a question about how these democratically organized scientific communities should decide, because if they're democratically organized, then, it seems that fundamentally that means that the members of the community are very diverse and they all vote, and then whoever wins gets to decide. But it seems like perhaps deliberation would be a better method to decide, and in that case, it seems like values would come into the deliberative process. So I was just wondering if you could say a bit more about that.
Sure, I would like to. I probably need to clarify that what I was describing were two different feminist empiricist approaches to contending with social values. One was get a diverse group together and let them work it out. Now, I saw a problem with that framework. One is we know that that those kind of deliberative processes don't necessarily result in anything conclusive. Group work doesn't always work well. And I thought it actually underlying that was an assumption that values couldn't be arbitrated except by some sort of consensus view. And I thought actually there's more to say about values, that we can actually evaluate their empirical content. So at least this is an idealized view. We might have contending social values where one really is stronger than the other for their empirical content alone, in which case you actually don't need that group to decide. So I think the second view, the empirical content, could actually exclude the need for a diversely represented group. You know, I could think of scenarios where you still might need further articulation, and I could see a standpoint theorist come in and say, but you might be missing important perspectives in the evaluation of that evidence. There's an allowance for that, but still, I would maintain that the two are actually two separate approaches to contending with social values.
Professor Psillos, you mentioned or suggested, I think, that social values should be applied in the later stages of the research process in the application. And Professor Goldenberg, I think you mentioned that social values could be applied both in the context of discovery and the context of justification. Do we still need to make that distinction between the contexts, or do we need to be careful and cognizant about applying social values throughout the process, or the research process, or the knowledge production process?
Yes, that's not a view I endorsed, but it's a view that it seems to me in the literature is popular among people who think that social values are involved, but they're not involved in coming to accept a theory, but in coming to see what consequences of the theory and how you practically use it, et cetera. I wanted to say that this distinction is not clearly the case when it comes to epistemic values. And when it comes to social values, I just wanted to express a caution in how they're used. And not in terms of saying that social values are not implicated, even when it comes to accepting. Descriptively, that's right. I mean, social values are involved. I mean, eugenicists, we're not just, disinterested scientists, okay, all of them or most of them, okay, or Nazi science or whatever was not just disinterested science. Descriptively is always there. I mean, normatively, I just wanted to make sure that we always have in mind the question that feminists and Marxist epistemologists have actually made prominent: whose values? What kind of values? And I thought that it's this question that needs to be addressed. In my recent reading of some of this literature, actually, which is not from the feminist point of view, they just bring the social values in as if magically solve the problems, and then they don't talk about the question: whose values, what kind of values, how they are justified, how we should prefer those values than others. Okay, that's the idea. So, Maya.
What I was trying to argue is I don't think social values can be held off until that application process. I think there's enough sociological research into various scientific practices that show that the social values are used all the way through. But what we don't want is that version where social values are not properly evaluated, and we don't have criteria for legitimate and illegitimate use. That's what allows for dogmatically held social values and the kind of worries that Professor Psillos raises.
Well, that brings us to the end of our sixth part of our Lives of Evidence, and thank you very much. I want to thank the Situating Science Share Cluster people, Victoria College, the Institute for History and Philosophy of Science, the Jackman Humanities Institute, Helena Lipwarnick, Maya Goldenberg, and Stathis Psillos. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Good night.